Today we'll be taking a look at the new Autel MaxiCOM MK908 diagnostic scan tool, and I will be using it to help diagnose and repair a P0172 code on a 2006 GMC 1500 with a flex fuel engine. After I finish the repair on the truck, we will take a closer look at the new scanner and the rest of the items that come with it in the kit, so be sure to stick around until the end of the video. Please be sure to like, comment, and subscribe. About 5 or 6 months ago, this truck tripped a P0172 trouble code on my way back on a road trip. And, of course, I didn't have an OBDII scanner to scan the code for me. So once I made it home, I pulled out my Autel MaxiCheck Pro that I bought a while back for bleeding brakes. And I was able to get the code, the P0172, and I looked at the fuel trim levels, and, you know, they were... The long terms were negative. The long terms were negative, like 25, and the fuel alcohol content was, I think, in the 30s, the 30%. So it's kind of a common problem on these GM flex fuel vehicles. They don't have an actual alcohol sensor on them. They use like O2 readings and whatnot for calculating the alcohol percentage after a fill up or whatnot. So sometimes the truck gets confused. For lack of a better explanation, the truck gets confused in its calculating of the alcohol content. And the only thing you can do is verify your alcohol content by taking a sample under the hood or out of your tank. And then if you do verify that it is 10% or less, all you do is you go in and reset the alcohol composition in the computer. So we're going to do that today, and I'm going to show you where we can find that information here on this truck. This is a 2006 GMC Sierra half-ton Z-code 5.3-liter flex-fuel engine. So we'll go to control unit, go to powertrain, we'll go to, well, first of all, let's go to live data. I'll turn the key on here. We'll go to live data, engine live data. We're going to go down to engine live data 2, and if we go down to the bottom here, on the right-hand side, we got fuel alcohol content, and right now it's showing 21%. Well, there is nobody around our area that sells anything close to 21%. We have either 10% or less, or E85. We do have E85 in this area. But we don't have anybody that sells 21%. And so if I start the truck here and we go up, this will affect the fuel trim levels, obviously. And if I go up here, we see this long-term fuel trim is at -5. This long-term fuel trim is at -7. Now, those aren't bad. Though, I mean, that's probably within the, you know, the normal range, if you will. However, at one time, these were much, much worse, and it has slowly started to relearn over time, but it's probably been at least 6 months, maybe longer. I can't remember exactly how long ago I had those trouble codes, but it, no matter how you look at it, 21%, I mean, we should be 10 or under, so that's at least double of what it should be, and so I'm going to reset it. This is my truck, and I want it right, but we're going to use this brand new Autel MaxiCOM MK908. I just got this thing, I don't know, a week or two ago, and this thing's pretty sweet. This is the new big scanner from Autel for 2019. So let's go out under the hood and let's take a fuel sample and see what we come up with. And then if we're under 10%, we're going to come in here and reset the fuel. Okay, guys, first thing we got to do is we got to go into diagnosis, control unit, powertrain. I think it's active tests, engine, fuel pump. Okay. What we need to do is cycle on our fuel pump. You can hear I got the ignition on in the truck. And so we do cycle the fuel pump, and then we're going to fill this graduated cylinder here. Let's see here. To 90 milliliters. I'm going to have to do this a few times, I see. All right, we're getting there. I'm going to go up to 90 milliliters with gasoline. And then we're going to fill the last 10 millimeters with just straight water. We got just a little bit left to go here. Oh. I think I got just enough here. I'm going to go dump off a little bit in my waste container. And I'll be back with you in just a second when I get this right at 90 milliliters. Okay, I'm back. I got this right at 90 milliliters. Of course, the top of the engine isn't very level. But trust me, it's right at 90. And then we're going to top off the rest of it with just straight water to the 100 mark. Might be just a tad much, but we're going to be, oh no, it's right on there. So then I'm going to cover it with my hand and carefully shake it. Mix it up real good. And then let it sit for a minute. And wherever the separation line is, that will give us an idea of where our actual fuel alcohol content is in this fuel. So I'm going to pause it here for a second, and we'll be back momentarily to check out the results. Okay, I've let it sit for a few minutes here, and I know it's going to be hard to see on here because of the camera angle, but I will include a picture on the screen right here to show you a close-up. But the water line is basically right at 15 or 16. Well, we added 10 milliliters of water, so that means there's 5 or 6 percent alcohol in this fuel. Or ethanol. So last time I checked the fuel alcohol content in the truck computer, it's at 21%. So it's way off and it needs to be reset. And that's what caused me to trip those codes a while back, was because the alcohol reading is wrong. So we're going to go in and we're going to reset the alcohol content and fuel trim on this truck. Okay, so, well, our results, it said we were at 6% alcohol. And the computer was showing, you know, 21%. We're going to reset the fuel trim and the fuel alcohol content composition. So let's see here. We're going to go back. Let's see. We're going to go back to active tests, engine. That's not it. Let's go back to special functions, fuel trim reset, fuel composition reset. Here we go. Says we're at 21, and our long terms are -7 and -5. Like I said, at one time, those were much worse. But either way, we're going to reset the counters. Now it says 3%, and our fuel trims all went to 0. So we're going to escape out of that. We're going to go to live data. Engine live data. I'm going to start the engine now. We'll go into engine data 2. And we're going to look at short term, long term. And then we're going to go all the way down to fuel alcohol, show selected. So there we have it. Now, obviously, I just started it, and it's relearning, but everything's looking pretty good at the moment. And so I'm going to take it for a little drive around town and see. I think we got to run, I don't know, like 10 miles or something. So we're going to take this thing for a ride up and down the highway, and then I'll get back with you, and we'll check out where it's at that point. All right. We're getting on the freeway here. So keep an eye on those trim numbers for fun. Hopefully you can see that. Hopefully the camera's not too shaky during rush hour here, so there is quite a bit of traffic. Okay, back from the test drive. As you can see, all the truck's still running, and the short term and long terms are all hovering right around 0, And the fuel alcohol content is still at 3, but that may take a while for it to do another, for it runs another cycle to calculate the actual content. But overall, I'm thrilled. I'm tickled pink. I'm very happy with the result. And I'm also really happy with this new Autel scanner. This is pretty sweet. This is the new big one for this year. Yeah, this thing is really beefy, really sturdy. I mean, this thing feels like a brick. I mean, it's really well made, got these nice grips on it and stuff. So I'll take you inside and show you the rest of the stuff that it comes with. Okay, so let's take a look at the new MaxiCOM MK908. This is it's a blow mold case, typical blow mold case. Most of the Autel stuff comes with one of these. And let's take a look inside here, see if we can get it all on camera. Down here at the bottom, we got the scanner itself. Pretty nice deal. I got all the different ports on there. Charge port, headphones, USB, another USB, HDMI, and a mini USB, and a power button. And again, there's a battery and SD card, a slot underneath this back door. And of course, there's the pull-out stand, which makes it nice. You can hook that on a steering wheel. That's pretty slick. Set that over there for now. The packing list. This is the packing list here. You can see it's got the main unit, the Bluetooth diagnostic interface, the main cable, USB cable, AC-DC adapter, charger, circuit lighter adapter, extra fuses, mini USB cable, the Honda adapter, Nissan, Mitsubishi, Hyundai, Kia, Benz, BMW, VW, Audi, GM, Daewoo, Chrysler, and then, of course, the user manual, the quick reference guide, packing list, soft cloth, and, of course, the carrying case. This does come with a bunch of adapters, which I'll show you. They look to me like they are, here in the USA, everything 1996 and newer is OBDII. So every car made after that here in the US has the same port, but these are OBDI adapters. So you can, hook up to an old vehicle or an older vehicle, or maybe vehicles that are out of the US. I don't know. I've never worked on a vehicle outside the US. But this is just some of the documentation. Of course, the user's manual, pretty nice. And let's take a look at what else comes with it here. Okay, on this side over here, you've got an extra US, oh no, let's see if you can see it here. This is a cigarette lighter adapter and a micro USB cable, a full-size USB cable, which I've already used to flash an update to the Bluetooth vehicle interface. But they show all these different adapters, like the Mitsubishi, Hyundai. I'm gonna slide it down here so you can get a, move it around here so you can get a better look. These are all the adapters on this side. You know, like I said, unless you're outside the United States or trying to connect to an old OBD1 vehicle, these are probably not gonna get used much nowadays. But it's nice that they come with it. And we'll go back around to this side. Just do this here. It's such a big case, it barely fits in the camera. Of course, you got what they call the main cable. And that hooks onto your Bluetooth. It's the wireless diagnostic interface. Now, this is the difference between... This is what the difference is between the MK908 and the MK908P. The P comes with the J2534 pass-through device, which is like another $800 or another $1,000 deal. But you only need that if you're going to do programming or coding of your vehicle. So your standard diagnostic and repair stuff, unless you got to replace a module and reflash something, this is the box that you need. And if you're going to do some recoding or reflashing, you'll need the J2534. But for your standard repair work and mechanic work, this gets you by for pretty much everything you need. And it works really good. It works very good. As soon as you turn on your device, this thing pairs instantly. It's not a problem. It always just works. And then in here, we've got it's a 110-volt charger adapter. It plugs into the wall for charging charging the scanner itself. So anyhow, that's a look at what all comes with the MK908, and of course, like I said, the P model would come with a different box over here, but
for just your standard diagnostic and bidirectional type control. This is all you need right here. So pretty nice setup, man. I'm telling you what, this thing's pretty slick. Everything's built very nice. And like I said, this tablet here feels very rigid, very, very sturdy. It's not a cheap piece of equipment at all. So it works really good. If you guys are interested in a scanner like this, I'll have a link down below where you can check it out. And thanks for watching.